Okay, so hello everybody. I will talk about ultrasound characterization of architecture and media achieved by additive manufacturing. And I am a PhD candidate in MSME under the supervision of Nicolas and Giuseppe. So 3D printing have been used for a lot of research areas. And in particular, I will talk about photopolymer-based additive manufacturing, which have been used for acoustics, for the design of tissue mimicking phantoms for high-frequency imaging applications, or for the design of passive components for biomedical applications, such as the development of lens for ultrasonic focus through the skulk and ultrasound therapy. In both applications, it requires a precise knowledge of the acoustic properties of the constituent materials, such as the phase velocity and the attenuation, as well as their frequency dependence. However, so far, most studies have been limited to longitudinal waves only. On the other hand, photopolymer-based multi-material additive manufacturing is also studied in mechanics, for the design of bio-inspired architectures for energy protection and impact protection applications, such as interpenetrating phase composites, or recreate wood-inspired helicoidal composites. Both applications provide structures with tunable and enhanced mechanical performance by making use of coupling mechanisms or topological optimizations. However, so far, most studies have been limited to the quasi-static regime. So in the framework of my thesis, we are interested in the development of ultrasound characterization tools for architectures with applications in biomechanics, in particular towards the monitoring of scaffold properties for bone defect reparations. So this type of scaffold is already used for this kind of orthopedic applications because first it allows to mimic the mechanical properties of the bone, and second it allows for a better regeneration of the bone inside the hole of the scaffold. So this type of architecture is already optimized for mechanical and biological purposes. And it is typically made of unit cells with sub-millimetric size, which means it should be sensible, mechanical waves should be sensible to periodic effects in the megahertz regime. And we are asking if we could use this kind of supplementary information for characterization purpose. So from a more abstract mechanical point of view, we consider this as a scaffold and a boning growth, so as a hard phase and a soft phase with no boundary condition, which means free periodic biphasic solid. And we will identify this as using the paradigm proposed by Zatpour as material ingredients, which in this case will be viscoelastic and mechanical, mechanistic ingredients. And the aim to use photopolymer-based multi-material to create this kind of architecture in a laboratory control environment. So we have material ingredients and mechanistic ingredients, such as periodicity, gradient, or hierarchy. And we can mix them to obtain new materials using multi-scale modeling or bio-inspiration, and model wave propagation with the classical tools we have seen so far. Like to add is an experiment based on multi-material sample 3D printed. And to do so, we first need to know precisely the characteristics of the material ingredients to calibrate the wave propagation model, and so we need to be interested in the homogeneous samples. And this will constitute the first part of my presentation. So we used two different 3D technologies to print homogeneous samples. The first one is called stereolithography. It's a layer-by-layer method with a resolution down to 50 micrometers, where we can use white or clear resin and play the curing time to obtain four samples, so uncured white, cured white, uncured clear, and cured clear. The other technology we used is called PolyJet. It's a multi-material technique, and it's a voxel-based method with voxel side length around 40 micrometers, where we can use a glassy polymer and an elastomer polymer and mix them at the scale of the voxel size to obtain any material with intermediate properties. And so we tried between 0 and 18% of elastomer material. So we used a double through transmission method in oblique incidence to characterize them. So it consists to immerge the sample as well as the transducer and reflector in water. We can obtain from this the front face reflection, the back face reflection, and deduce the longitudinal bulk properties expressed as the phase velocity and the attenuation of the longitudinal wave. In the same manner, we can measure the double through transmission and the double transmission in oblique incidence, where we rotate the sample angle greater than the vertical angle so that only transverse waves are propagated inside the medium. And from these two measurements, we can deduce transverse bulk properties expressed as the phase velocity and the attenuation of the transverse wave. So we used one 32-element multi-element probe driven with multi-channel electronics with a central frequency of 2.25 MHz. And we emit a plane wave by simultaneously exciting all the elements of the transducer. And then we average over the 32 elements to get the reflection back. And we obtain this kind of measurements. Here is the front face, back face, double through transmission, and double through transmission with oblique incidence, which can be expressed in the Fourier domain after applying proper signal windowing and circular shifting to obtain finally the longitudinal and transverse phase velocities and attenuation at the frequency. So here we can see that there is a slight dispersion for both modes of propagation, and a quasi-linear frequency dependence of the attenuation, which, as you may know, cannot be captured by classical rheological models such as Voigt model, which will predict an attenuation proportional to omega square. So if we want to capture this kind of effects, we need alternative models. So here is the Chabot Waves equation, which have been proposed in the early 90s. It's based on the assumption of a power law attenuation and a causal process. And it's a classical wave propagation equation with an additional term which involves fractional derivatives. And these terms account for the dispersive losses. We can deduce the dispersion relation and deduce the expression for the phase velocity and the attenuation as a function of four parameters. And what this expression tells us is that the dispersion is not independent from the attenuation. So I fitted the model fitted the experimental data with the model using a classic minimization procedure. And here are the results for the longitudinal waves and the shear waves. So we observe in both cases good agreement with on the useful frequency bandwidth. And here are the results for all tested samples. So on the left and in the middle, it's uncured. We see that there is not a significant effect of the curing. And on the right, when we increase the volume fraction of elastomer materials, it decreases the phase velocity and it increases the global attenuation. Similar results for transverse bulk properties, except it's more sensitive to the curing process. And what important point is that since we know the phase velocity of the longitudinal and shear waves, we can calculate the engineering moduli, and we observe, especially for the the Young modulus, a significant difference with quasi-static experiments, as the Young modulus is twice the one you obtain with quasi-static experiments. And it's still an open question, but we imagine it might be due to viscoelasticity, and it highlights the importance to characterize this type of materials in this frequency range. So I will go to the second part where we will be interested in periodicity mostly. So we used only this time polyjet technique, which allowed to design materials with unit cells of some millimetric size, and we would like to scale the samples for the ultrasound measurement setup and verify if we can obtain predictable ultrasonic responses. To do so, we need to model the ultrasonic propagation across samples with multiphasic periodic, which is a multiphasic periodic materials with viscoelastic properties and will be of finite size, so we can't model it as completely infinite. And the aim at the end is to explore complex geometries such as those presented by Giuseppe just before. But since we are mostly interested in testing the experimental setup, we will look at the simplest periodicity, which is 1D periodicity, because it's very easy to model. We can do it analytically. It will allow us to scale the samples to verify the predictability of the ultrasonic response and to disentangle the relative contributions of periodic effects, viscoelastic effects, and effects due to interferences due to the finite size. So as I said, in this 1D case, it's easy, it can be solved analytically by expressing the solution for the displacement as the sum of forward wave and backward wave propagating in the material. And we can relate the output on the right to the input on the left with the transfer matrix, which depend on the properties of each layer. On the other hand, we can apply block periodic boundary conditions, which basically says that the solution in the next unit cell is the same than in the previous one, with just an additional phase term involving what we call the block wave number. And given these two equations, we have an eigenvalue problem that can be solved to obtain the dispersion relation. If we start by considering elastic constituent materials, we obtain this kind of curves, the same than before, except here it's represented in a three dimension. So we see the real part and the imaginary part as a function of the frequency. And we see that outside the bound gap, the solution is only in the real plane. And inside the bound gaps, the solution is only in the imaginary plane. However, if we consider viscoelastic constituent materials with attenuation and dispersion, we see that the solution is a bit more complex and we cannot as easily identify the bound gaps since there is always a real and an imaginary part. This can be expressed as phase velocity and attenuation since it's what we measure at the end. And here we observe that we still have this slow increase of phase velocity and attenuation which come from the viscoelasticity. We have more sudden variations which comes from the periodicity. And we have a coupling effect between viscoelasticity and periodicity as the total is not just the addition of the two. However, we must remember that block Floquet analysis is valid only for infinite medium, and we would like to know how many units take into account to see this kind of effects. So we go back to the transfer matrix formalism, and we can describe a system made of n repetition of the unit cell by expressing this its total transfer matrix as the transfer matrix of one unit cell multiplied n times by itself. Therefore, we can compute the transfer function after applying Sommerfeld radiation conditions. So it relates the output on the right to the input on the left. And if we model it as simply one wave propagating from the left to the right with a propagation constant Kn, which will depend on the number of repetition, we press the equivalent phase velocity and attenuation. Here is the result obtained with block Floquet analysis and for a finite medium with only one unit cells. And on the bottom, it's a measure of the difference between the two curves. So we see that as we increase the number of unit cells, the error of block Floquet is less. And the two results converge. And it continues. So from these models, we could design three samples with constant volume fraction and thickness around 8 millimeters by only varying the number of unit cells in the total width. So it also changes the thickness of each unit cell. And here are pictures taken with a microscope. For the experimental validation, it's pretty much the same as in the first part, except this time we work in transmission and use as a reference wave, a wave transmitted only through water. Here is the wave transmitted only through water and the wave transmitted through the material, where we see an additional coda which comes from the multiple scattering inside the material. And in Fourier domain, it becomes an attenuation across this frequency band and a shift of the phase. Similarly, we can compute the phase velocity and the attenuation. And here are the results for the first one. So in green, it's an infinite medium. In red, it's the finite medium and the experimental measurement. So we see a good agreement on this frequency range, but no more agreement here, since we are not able to measure precisely what happened, as we obtain more than 90 dB centimeter, which correspond to a division of the amplitude by more than 30,000 factor. And if we increase the width of the unit cell, we see the band gap shifting towards lower frequencies and a second band gap which appears. And if we continue, this time we have three band gaps, and we begin to see that as the number of unit cells is begin to be low, the block analysis is not that precise anymore. So, as a conclusion, we have measured ultrasonic longitudinal and transverse viscoelastic properties in homogeneous 3D printed samples. We have also characterized 1D periodic multimaterial samples which have been tuned for megahertz regime, and we have seen predictable ultrasonic responses. And finally, the models were in good agreement with the experimental results, taking into account the periodicity, the viscoelasticity, and the finite size nature of the sample. For future works, we would like to progressively extend this to more complex geometries, such as geroids, and see if we can replicate this kind of measurement with reflection and extend oblique incidence, which should give out the anisotropy. An outlook, we still don't have the model which goes here, but we already measured 2D periodic square inclusions, and we can see that this time we keep the same width of the unit cell, but we just change the volume fraction, and there is a sensitivity on the global phase velocity and attenuation, as well as on the position of the measured band gaps. And thank you. Thank you.